Welcome, crime lovers, to part two of episode 11, White Menace, the dreaded Corolla, with your hosts, Jehan
and Naz.
So now let's dip into the aftermath, featuring interviews with Ali, Umair, and Gul. Remember Gul, Ali's father? So let's start with Gul Muhammad's statement. The interviewer inquired about Gul's son, Ali, and his alleged involvement with the White Corolla gang. However, Gul was quick to deny any connection, placing the blame on the police for falsely accusing his family.
Wait, so you're saying that Gul Muhammad is saying that the police is at fault here?
Yeah. When asked why the police would register FIRs against his son Ali, Gul responded by asserting that the police had a history of falsely registering cases against him, his older son, and now they're doing the same thing to Ali. Basically, Gul turns around and says that the police had like a long history of registering cases against them, and it started in the 70s because he was connected to political parties.
It's connection to politics, which is why he's saying
politics.
He's being framed, basically. His family is being falsely targeted for crimes that they have not committed. Wow.
This rivalry that he had with another political gang, which was very, very big and still stands very, very big in Pakistan, that killed his older son.
Oh, okay.
So he just perceives it as another attempt by the police to bring him and his family down. So then the interviewer questioned Gul about why he did not pursue a damage claim against the police. Because if the police is falsely registering cases against them, you can counteract that with a damage claim.
True.
But Gul said that due to his unemployment, because he's retired now, and because there is a sole reliance on just his pension, he was constrained in pursuing such claims. Like, you have a rent-a-car business, you have Mercs, Corollas, and Hiluxes just out there in your backyard, but you can't register a damage claim?
Yeah, obviously the income is coming in, even if he's retired or whatever, he has a business. So plus pension. So I'm really not thinking that money is the issue here. It's because he doesn't have enough evidence, I guess, to make a claim that this is a falsely created story or there's any sort of involvement of the police trying to frame his family. It's all just in his mind, and it's purely just an excuse.
Yep, exactly. So he says that the process itself of like registering a damage claim is like 50,000 rupees, which is a very big financial burden. But just like you said, he's still getting income from the rent-a-car business. He still gets pension. If you're so hell-bent on this thought that the police are against you and they're falsely accusing you of things that you're innocent of, then register that damage claim. What's stopping you? Yeah. But just like you said, He's using it as an excuse, but it's a weak one. It's a weak excuse, for sure. Basically, throughout the interview, there was just constant putting down the police, saying that this is propaganda against him and his family. So when the interviewer probed Gul about the murder of Fida, the transgender, the hijra, stating that there were three witnesses who had testified against Ali, Gul turned around and said that nothing was mentioned about any eyewitnesses in the list of evidence that was submitted to him. And if there is an eyewitness, then that should have been added into that list so he can cross-examine it and he can basically defend his son against it.
Wait, is Gul Muhammad representing him, sorry, representing his son as his like lawyer? What's going on here?
It did kind of mention that he was an advocate as well.
Isn't that like a conflict of interest?
Yeah, but I think he basically, what he meant by this was that this eyewitness that you're talking about, or these three eyewitnesses, if that was real, then our lawyers would have known. It would have been a part of, because obviously, when a case starts, both lawyers get everything related to that case. So I think his way of turning it around was like, what eyewitnesses? If that was factual, it would be in the list of evidence, but it's not there. So I think what happened here was that whether that list was given to him or not, which it was, I think it was, everything is just about just deflection.
Yeah, that's so weak.
So following Ali's arrest, the discovery of a white Corolla in Ali's possession raised suspicion. And the interviewer obviously asked Gul, what do you say about that? But Gul completely avoided that question. He completely just switched the conversation to, it's all false. They're just, this is propaganda. My son is not involved in any such crimes.
Parents like this that enable their children, that's what they do. They enable their children by coming to their defense, even though I'm sure he is 100% certain that his son was involved in all of the charges against him. He's still defending his son. And I don't understand. And there's a lot of parents like that. It's actually quite sad. But I don't even know what it is, like narcissism. I don't know what it is, but where they just cannot admit that their children were in the wrong, especially when it comes to anything criminal. It's just like, no, my child could never. Whereas they know that it is totally a possibility. In this case, there's evidence, and still he's denying it.
I agree. But I can tell you, hands down, in the Desi community, enabling male behavior like this is ha 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 ha, wo to ladka hai, he's just a boy. It's a male thing, it's a guy thing. God forbid a girl does even 3% of what the guy does, she's a slut. Ye kharab hai. She's from a bad family. We have a lot of what you're saying, enabling the abuser. Just because he's your damn blood, don't do that. Do not enable violence. Do not cover up such acts. It's insane. I cannot even, like, I don't know. Just
Yeah.
sad.
And there, you're right. There's that double standard where the son does something and he can get away with it, literally get away with murder. But the daughter does something, or forget actually doing something, being accused of doing something. So it's not even proven. And then there's that whole, oh, she's dishonoring our family. Let's just kill her. It's such a problem. It's such a problem in our, like, this Desi society. I wish it wasn't like this, but this has been happening for like centuries.
So I do want to mention over here, I was going to mention it a little later, but since we're on Gul, I think this is the right time to put this in. In 2002, Gul Muhammad had assisted Umber Sultana in securing a government school teaching position.
Okay.
But then in 2012, Gul Muhammad, who at that time was 70 years old, and he was a retired executive district officer, was arrested on December 5th, 2012, for the alleged abduction of a woman.
So he...
It was the same Umber Sultana. I think in between, you know, initially in the initial years, I think he was just pursuing her, trying to get her on his good side, trying to like get, you know, the girl vibes out. And then initially the first thing he did was when she rejected his proposal, he stopped her salary because he had the power to. He was the executive district officer. And I think he made like trouble for her to kind of like make her sway more into his direction, but that didn't work.
Okay.
Then there was a legal battle. Umber successfully had her salary reinstated. Eventually, December 5th, he got frustrated. He asked his son-in-law and his son-in-law's friend to go bring her. They abducted her, brought her to the apartment, tortured her, raped her. She called the police. And then they were arrested. But I think it's important to like kind of show that this is Gul's mentality. This is what Ali is growing up around. This is one case that has come out. Ali's not making complete sense, but now I can like connect the dots, you know?
Well, you know, they say the apple doesn't fall far from the tree. You've heard that, right?
Yeah, very true. Very true in this case. And Naz, wait. Gul was very well connected, right? So he was granted bail on account of his age.
Okay.
The other two were sent to prison. But because he was 70, they were like, oh, you just pay some money and, you know, go on your merry way.
So when did the justice system look at age?
No. It's not because of the age. It's because he was influential. It was because he was a part of the government. It was because he was backed by a political party. Age was just the excuse. He was very well connected, which is why he got off scot-free. Ali got off scot-free.
How can both father and son get away with all of these crimes?
I think that kind of makes Ali feel invincible, like you said in the last episode. That he feels invincible. He feels nothing can touch him. So what if he gets caught? His daddy will bail him out.
Oh my God.
Because his daddy himself has been bailed out probably multiple times.
That's just disgusting.
Yeah. This is very upsetting to hear. How power and money can change justice, the verdict, justice, the whole concept of being fair.
Yeah. Sad reality.
Unfortunately. Now we're going to move on to Umair's interview. During Umair's interview, he revealed the unsettling truth about his partnership in criminal exploits with Ali, spanning 7 to 9 months.
Umair is actually owning up to his crimes here?
Mm-hmm. He's a mechanic. Mechanic in Pakistan is very different from a mechanic, car painter abroad. People with not a lot of education tend to become mechanics or car painters or painters, so they're not very well off. His immediate thing was confess, get it all out there, be upfront, because I don't have no daddy to save me.
That's true. Everybody's not that lucky, I guess.
So he confessed that together they had committed over 40 criminal acts, which encompassed robberies and thefts. 40.
My goodness. So I wonder what else they've done. And I wonder what else was unreported.
Yeah. It's scary to think about. Furthermore, Umair, in a very confessional tone, bore witness an alarming number of violent acts, including 10 to 15 instances of rape, all executed by Ali.
I think that's accurate. But is that the truth? I guess that we won't know.
That's the thing. We would never know. So Umair wanted to make it very clear that he was just a spectator. He goes on to say, quote, I feel sorry for those who got raped. I don't feel bad about the robberies we committed, but Ali shouldn't have raped those women. I would
Oh.
tell him, don't do this, Ali. But he'd be so high, he wouldn't listen to me. The women would be crying and screaming, but Ali showed no mercy, unquote.
Okay, big man. Really, I have so much to say here. First of all, I would tell Ali, stop, don't do this. Hello, what about reporting him to the police? Okay, you could have stopped it right then and there if it was so out of your moral compass and, you know, all of that. Number one. Number two, there was no mention of drugs in this case, but you're saying that in this interview, Umair says Ali was so high, meaning there was some kind of a drug involvement.
Yeah, hash, lots of hash.
Oh, great. So this case
It
covers it
doesn't
all.
make
We're
it.
like, is there anything left?
Yeah, it's just insane. I did not think, Naz, that when I was doing the white roller case, it would get this intense. And I think even this number that he says, 10 to 15 instances of rape, okay, Umair, right, we believe you. And for 15 rapes, you told him, don't do this. For 15 rapes, that's 15 times you asked him to stop, yet you didn't really do anything.
Umair is quite something.
I can see why Umair and Ali are friends.
Yeah, I see it. Although one might have the status and the influence with his father and all of that, and the other one doesn't, unfortunately, but they still have the same sick and disgusted mentality, and they're both equally at fault here.
Exactly. I don't care if you didn't take part in the rape. You were in the car. You did not stop it. You let it happen 10 to 15 times with 10 to 15 different girls. You are as guilty as Ali. So here's the twist. When asked about the consistency between Umair and Ali's statements, which I will get to in a minute, Gul Mohammed said that the police had basically forced them to admit to these crimes. He went on to say that the police beat and torture you to confess what they think is true. However, when the interviewer provides evidence of Ali's involvement in the crimes related to the White Corolla gang, Gul retaliated by saying that once you're in police custody, even the innocent are forced into fitting the narrative of the police.
Gul really insists
Clearly,
that the police had something to do with this. I just don't
yeah.
understand this uncle's mindset.
Do not understand Gul's mindset. And here, like Ali himself is saying, yes, I did it. And Gul is saying, no. Now it comes to that part of the episode, which I have to give a warning to all our listeners. Ali's interview includes extremely triggering and uneasy content. Specific details of his acts will not be disclosed, but this unsettling feeling is just due to his responses. So, are you ready for this, Naz?
Yeah, I wanna hear this guy's voice.
The interview with Ali starts off with where the interviewer was welcomed with a warning stating, quote, "There will be a day when you and I will meet outside. Pray that we never come face to face." Once I am released.
Wow, I can't believe he made a threat to the interviewer.
लेकिन जिंदगी में ये भी याद रखना, कभी जिंदगी में मेरी और आदमी मुलाकात भी हो, लेकिन जिंदगी में ये अल्लाह से हमेशा दुआ करना कि तेरा मेरा सामना ना हो।
Wow, he sounds so nonchalant. Oh my goodness.
Yeah. So entitled. So
I don't
entitled.
understand. I don't understand. He doesn't have any remorse in his voice.
No remorse. The calmness in his voice during the interview was undeniably frightening, especially when he admitted to the crimes for which he was arrested. He acknowledged the validity of his arrest, also claiming that the police should have caught him sooner. He also stated that his actions were due to being in a constant state of drug-induced intoxication, claiming, quote, "I am always high on drugs, and I may have done what I did when I was high. I don't remember."
Well, just because you were high on drugs doesn't give you a free pass to do whatever you want. I mean, that itself is a crime. Why are you high on drugs all the time? And where are you getting them?
You're implicating yourself by not only committing these crimes, but also saying that you're high all the time. You don't remember.
इसने बिल्कुल सही पकड़ा, इनको तो बल्कि बहुत पहले पकड़ना चाहिए था मुझे, क्योंकि जो मैंने काम कर रहा था ऐसे, मैं नशे में होता हूँ, हो सकता है सब्र होती हूँ और मुझे ना याद रहा हो.
Why is this guy so calm?
So calm.
He is right. Such a psycho.
Yeah. And he says it with like such a the police should have caught me sooner. I have done these crimes, but they should have caught me sooner. Like it's the police's fault for not catching him sooner.
This is actually so upsetting. Like it's funny. That's how upsetting it is, you know?
Yeah, because it makes you so angry. It makes you so uneasy that you don't know what to do, but kind of laugh.
Yeah, exactly.
The paradox emerged when Ali, in the same breath, professed his fear of God and then fully acknowledged his actions. This contradiction raises a perplexing question. How can one express a fear of a higher power while committing such evil crimes against innocent individuals? He claims he's not fearful of the media nor the police. And the only thing he is fearful of is God.
मैं बिल्कुल करता हूँ जी, आपके सामने नहीं, अल्लाह के सामने करता हूँ. ना मैं आपसे डरता हूँ, ना मैं पुलिस से डरता हूँ, सिर्फ डरता हूँ अल्लाह की जात से.
सिर्फ डरता है अल्लाह की जात से.
That means if he's truly fearful of God, then why the hell did he do what he did?
I don't know.
Maybe he was so high on drugs he thought that God was taking a day off.
I do not understand this guy's mentality, and I'm glad. When Ali was confronted by the interviewer regarding this apparent contradiction, Ali responded with a sense of irritation, saying, "It's not like I did it every day. I would do it once in 5 days, sometimes once in 10 days, sometimes after 2 days. I didn't do it every day."
Oh, wow. Thank you for being such a great guy.
thanks for not doing it every day.
डर तो अल्लाह का डर था ना भाई, डर तो अल्लाह की जात से था. मैंने कहा ना, डर तो अल्लाह की जात से था. और मैं कौन सा रोज करता था वैसे, कभी 5 दिन बाद, कभी दूसरे दिन, कभी 10वें दिन, इस तरह भी करते थे.
Like irritated, like you know, like
I would lose my shit if I was that interviewer. Honestly, I'm so glad I'm not a reporter, like a real reporter. But yeah. A person like this guy would get under my skin so quickly. I would just flip.
I agree. I think there's a reason why mostly our media, our journalists are men. Because I don't think we could keep our emotions in check. Especially when this guy is being so, yeah, I did it. Oof, why are you asking me? I mean, I only did it like once in every 5 days. I didn't do it all the time. Okay,
that's true. I feel like women would not be able to contain their emotions, that's for sure.
Yeah. Then the interviewer, he asked Ali, "Are you confessing to all of this while you're in your senses without any force or pressure?" Ali replies, still very irritated, "No one needs to pressure me to say anything. I've told you, I don't fear you. I only fear God and Prophet Muhammad."
Bhai, aap keh rahe hain to bilkul main hosho awaaz mein hi baat kar raha hu na. ये आपने मुझे मारा तो नहीं है कि जबरदस्ती बयान दो भैया, मुझे आपका डर नहीं है, मुझे डर है सिर्फ अल्लाह की जात का या रसूल का डर है, और मुझे कोई डर नहीं है,
और कोई डर नहीं है इसे. His response, his demeanor throughout the interview, it baffles me.
I mean, if he's this afraid of God, then seriously, I don't see why he would do what he's doing. And I don't, okay, forget that. He did it, fine. Maybe deep down he is remorseful, or he truly had no idea what he was doing. Okay. But then the irritation with which he's talking and the lack of humility or embarrassment,
empathy.
And empathy, it's just like, so then you don't even fear God, you know? Like,
That's the thing. That's the contradiction. How can you have fear of God and then in that same breath be like, yeah, I committed it. No big deal. I didn't do it every day. Why are you questioning me the way you are? Like, what? During the interview, Ali was asked if he sold the mobiles or watches for cash. He said he never sold the watches or mobiles, he wrote. If he liked a mobile, he would use it himself. Or the stolen watches, he would wear them for his office meetings at the rent-a-car business, proudly wearing. The interviewer asked him, what about the jewelry that you stole? What would you do with that? So Ali confessed that he would go to Sadr. Sadr is basically the center or the downtown of Karachi. And you can buy everything under the sun there for extremely cheap prices. And in fact, robberies are very common in Karachi specifically. Whatever stolen can be sold, no questions asked. So just so that you get a clearer picture of this, Ali would sit in his black Mercedes Benz with a fancy green number plate that read Advocate High Court, because his father is said to be an advocate. It's in green to show everyone else and the police that this is a government car. Don't touch it. Don't stop them. No traffic rules apply to them. And then he would drive from Defense, where he lived, to Sadr, which is 9 kilometers, to sell the stolen jewelry.
All while being in this police and authority protected vehicle, all mm-hmm. thanks to his father.
Yep.
I mean, I know our audience can't see me right now, but I'm literally shaking my head in disgust.
Same. So you're not doing it for the money, because you don't need the money. You're clearly doing it for fun.
That's a thrill.
For the excitement, because you can get away with it. When they were finally arrested, the police found 2 9mm pistols, a variety of purses and wallets, 60 Rolex watches.
Oh my God.
60.
Does that mean that they were targeting like really rich people? Because how do you get 60 Rolex watches? Does the average Pakistani have a Rolex?
No. The average Pakistani doesn't. It does not make sense. It does not add up to the number of victims that Umair or Ali confess to having. You do get fakes, which look very real, first copies. But I can't say that all 60 were fake.
So I think that maybe March 2008 is when we think all of this started. But maybe he was robbing people through a different medium. Like maybe it wasn't with this, you know, white Corolla, whatever. But maybe he was robbing people through other means. And that's why now he has a collection of 60.
When I was researching, there was also this copycat gang, which I don't know if he had involvement in or not, because I didn't see his name there. But they basically had robbed 15 houses back to back in Defense, where they robbed them of laptops, jewelry, cash, wallets, everything, all gone. So I'm really, when I was researching this case, I was really confused. I was like, is he a part of that? Like, this is where the numbers just don't add up.
That's so maybe what? Maybe he did have more than one gang, and maybe they had more than one technique and motive.
Yeah.
Or
I believe that. I believe, like you're saying, it happened way before than March. And I also believe that it wasn't just cruising and just stopping. I think it probably started that way, but I think it did escalate to stopping people while they were driving into their house, or stopping people while they were parked outside their house. I think that also was a part of it. But I can't say for sure.
Could it also be that they actually did select their victims, and all along we thought it was random?
But the thing is, if you're targeting people in Defense in Clifton, you know for sure this is where the wealth is.
But like I said, does every wealthy individual in that part of Karachi wear a Rolex?
Yeah. Most of them that I know do. Yeah. Oh no, in Karachi you'll see individuals walking around with diamonds and gold and Rolexes, and in their big cars with a whole platoon of policemen behind them, protecting them, bulletproof cars. I just feel there was a reason why he targeted DHA and Clifton and not, let's say, Kurangi or Gulshan, which still has wealthy people there too. But the creme of the creme is in DHA.
Okay.
Was in DHA. Apart from the purses, the wallets, the 60 Rolex watches, they also come pound jewelry worth millions of rupees, cell phones, and ATM cards from various banks. And surprisingly, Nas and all our crime fanatics, I have not even mentioned the worst part of this interview yet.
Oh boy, what's that now?
So Ali, he apologized during the interview, but Ali's apology was directed solely to his family with no acknowledgement or remorse expressed towards the victims and their families. He says, quote, "I apologize to my family. I humbly apologize to my family if they are watching this." When the interviewer asks, "Would you like to apologize to your victims?" Ali states, "I am asking forgiveness from God. I won't apologize to women. In front of God, what is the status of a woman? Nothing. So
Okay.
I don't need to apologize to any woman."
There's a lot of respect for women in the religion of Islam, that is for certain.
He says, "औरत की क्या औकात है? What is the status of a woman? कुछ नहीं, nothing. So I do not need to apologize to any woman."
Like running out of words for how I feel about this guy.
लड़कियों की मैं हाथ पांव तो नहीं जोड़ूंगा, ठीक है? अल्लाह से माफी मांग रहा हूँ, तो लड़की की क्या औकात है? खत्म, मेरे लिए कुछ भी नहीं है लड़की। अल्लाह और रसूल से माफी मांग रहा हूँ, लड़की क्या है? खत्म।
लड़की क्या है? खत्म. God, when I heard this, I really just wanted to, even though I was watching him through a laptop, I wanted to grab hold of his neck and squeeze it as hard as I could and say, "ये है औकात.
Yeah,
This is the
exactly.
status of a woman." I was really bursting with anger and repulsion, and I'm in that moment right now, and I'm sure you, Naz, and anyone else who's listening will be like, do you have no shame?
He's got none. He's got no remorse and sympathy or empathy, or he doesn't even really acknowledge that he's done anything wrong. So when somebody is that far removed from reality, you can't have any expectations from that person. Didn't he have a wife? You also said he has a daughter. Is that right? So if ladki ki koi aukaat nahi hai, then he has two women or two females in his life who have absolutely no value and no relevance. So again, he's not all, I don't think he fully understands what he's saying. Like, he's so far removed from reality, he has no idea what he's saying.
Yeah, but aren't narcissists like that?
Classic
They
sign.
believe their own reality. They believe they're above everyone else. They believe everyone's beneath them. And I think this is why earlier on in the first part of this episode, I did kind of mention that I would want to know what his relationship with his mother was like. Because it would kind of maybe give you a little insight into why he thinks that women are of no status, no value.
Maybe his father treated his mother like absolute crap.
It clearly shows that there is this keep women underneath your feet, which unfortunately is very common in Pakistan, that mindset going on in their house. And men can get away with everything.
Just horrible.
And if this hasn't left you feeling disgusted by this guy already, this is how he ended the interview.
So he's openly threatening the interviewer on, I'm assuming, national TV.
Quote, "If my pictures are leaked or published, then you are starting a war with me. I will be your worst enemy if you publish my pictures."
और मेरी आपसे ये रिक्वेस्ट होगी कि मेरी तस्वीर नहीं आनी चाहिए। अगर तस्वीर आई तो मैं आपसे खुला कह रहा हूं कि मेरी और आपकी दुश्मनी है, फिर बिल्कुल खुला, आपकी इनकी मेरी दुश्मनी है फिर।
So we are now at the last bit of our episode. Naz, you've been waiting for this, the verdict. In Jan 2009, Ali and Umair were booked in for at least 45 cases of rape, attempt to murder, and robbery.
45 cases now.
The culprits were described by the investigators as repulsive criminals who drove around in a white Toyota Corolla car, robbed families, raped women, and even transgenders who were often seen begging on the roadside. The two were charged with murder, robbery, disgracing women, and carrying illicit weapons, but not rape.
Wait, excuse me?
You heard that right.
No rape?
No rape. Imtiaz Khan, a staffer at the court where Ali and Umair were being tried, stated, quote, "This is merely because no rape case was lodged against them." The police officer in charge of this case stated that the victims had shared their stories with the police, but not every rape victim was comfortable or wanted to register an FIR. And again, this is very common in countries like Pakistan. Unfortunately, women and girls who are raped are victim blamed with the fear of being ostracized. Many victims may not have even lodged a complaint, and those who did were probably discouraged by their families, as it would tarnish the family's reputation and name.
So out of like the 15-ish known sexual assault cases within this case itself, within this white Corolla gang, not even one person came forward and said, now that they're in custody and now that there's going to be a case built against them, maybe I should just mention that, you know, I was also sexually assaulted.
But that's the thing, Naz, this whole concept of victim blaming culture that we have in Pakistan, it stops victims from coming forward. Because even though it's not their fault, whether they were out alone or whether they were dressed in a certain way, the blame is never on the culprit. It is always on the victim. And this victim blaming culture has got to change so that victims come out and report being sexually harassed or raped.
That means there are probably thousands and thousands of people, females, in Pakistan who have had some form of sexual abuse or violence committed against them, and they have been living with that their entire life and have not been able to get any justice for the injustices committed against them.
Yeah, unfortunately. I can understand why women did not want to lodge an FIR.
Again, you can't see me, but I'm really shaking my head hard.
I'm sure. It's so upsetting. It is so upsetting. Because in other countries, there is some sort of justice given. When I hear cases where they say, oh, you know, only 5 years or only 10 years, I'm just like, oh my God, how lucky. How lucky that it's 5 years. We don't even get that.
So then what punishment did these guys get?
Even though the police completed their investigations and submitted the charge sheets against the two in nearly all the cases by February 2009, the trial continued. It took the court nearly 6 years to find the duo guilty of robberies in 7 cases.
Even robberies took this long?
Imtiaz, the court staffer, said there was a total of 250 witnesses, including victims, who were named, but most of them failed to appear in court. He stated, quote, "People believe that testifying against the suspects will land them in trouble," unquote. On average, the court heard one witness a month, with around 70 witnesses still left. If the court maintained the same pace, it would have taken 5 years for all the cases to be heard and decided. So in response, Ali appealed and claimed that he was innocent and being victimized by his father's political rivals. Before I disclose his final verdict, we haven't covered the murder of Fida, the Hijra. With respect to the murder of Fida, Ali and Umair denied having any involvement in that murder, although there were witnesses present at the time Fida was shot. The post-mortem report stated that Fida suffered from firearm injury on her left nipple, showing the wound of entry. Her heart was punctured and showed the track bullet on the back of the right chest. There was no doubt that the accused was murdered by the use of a firearm.
The way you're describing her post-mortem report, it feels like purely like revenge.
Vengeful, yes. There were three eyewitnesses to the crime. Out of the three eyewitnesses, only one, who was Kawar Abbas, was examined, because the remaining two who identified the accused before the magistrate could not be examined, as both had left their residence with no forwarding address.
God, they were probably threatened.
Most probably. Kawar stated that when Ali shot Fida, he was only 10 paces away from Ali, and the area was opposite a hospital that was fully lit. Therefore, Kawar got a very good view of Ali. When this came up, Ali appealed by saying, "How do you know it's me? This is a chance witness." So this is a statement Kawar gave.
Wow.
Furthermore, Ali's cap was found at the scene, at the crime scene near Fida's body, and that was sent for DNA testing to cross-check if it matched Ali's DNA sample, which it did. So in 2015, the appeal that Ali had submitted was rejected, and Ali was convicted and sentenced with imprisonment for life. He also had to pay a fine of a merely 50,000 rupees for the murder of Fida Hussain.
50,000 rupees is nothing, but the life sentence is huge, nothing. Actually. Well, if he truly has to spend that time, then that's a big deal. And if he does not, because his father's connections, then that's a whole other issue.
Mm-hmm. I think although the verdict does favor the victims, well, Fida, I cannot guarantee you that he is in prison.
So you're saying there's a chance that even now, 2024, he is out of jail already?
Mm-hmm. I think it's possible. In July 2016, the two men faced convictions in approximately 7 cases, but were acquitted in twice that number, with several cases still pending. For certain offenses, they were handed 15-year jail sentences. So as of the present moment, concerning just the robberies, both individuals have completed their jail sentences and would have been released last year in 2023. However, due to the imprisonment linked to murder, Ali should still be in prison. Despite a rejected bail application, there are speculations that due to his father being well-connected, his legal team might have identified loopholes in the murder case, potentially leading to a lighter sentence. So we don't know, but it's very upsetting. And you know, this whole buildup of the case and the details of the case, and just there's so much focus on Gul and how Gul even escaped a very similar crime, right? The buildup was such where I tried to prepare you guys to the end, which is, it's not looking pretty.
Is this Gul uncle still alive and kicking?
I love how you're calling him Gul uncle. I don't know. There is no mention of his death or anything. So I think he's still alive and kicking.
Great.
But I do want to like end this episode with survivor statements. People who thankfully outsmarted Ali and were able to escape. So victim one. I live on Main Kabane Beharia and my mother lives on the other side of the street. Some nights ago, I had just made a U-turn and was parked outside my mother's place when a white Corolla pulled up and the man in the car pointed a gun at me. At first, I pretended that I hadn't seen him. But when he started tapping on my window with a gun, I reacted on impulse and sped away before he could react. All the while, blowing the horn, which is so smart. They chased after me, but when they saw that I was attracting a lot of attention, they drove away.
Yeah,
so blow the horn.
Yeah, just keep it going nonstop. It'll get somebody's attention.
Exactly. And it saved her. Victim two. My husband, our daughters, and I were all in the car returning from a dholki, which is a small wedding event. And we were on Klabane Shaheen, just about to turn into our street, when we noticed a white Corolla speeding behind us, as if it was going to hit us. My husband slowed down to let him pass. Suddenly, my daughter screamed that the man in the car, now next to us, had a gun in his hands. Without thinking, I told my husband to just drive. The car kept following us, but since we were familiar with the area, my husband pulled up in front of a house where he knew there were guards outside. So the car drove away.
Also very smart.
So another tip. If you're being followed, either go to a police station or go to an area where you know will have guards or police.
But Jihan, in terms of this specific incident, there was a child in the car. Now I'm feeling even more like there might have even been some minor victims.
We don't know the names of the victims, obviously. We don't know who they were. I'm just hoping that he is actually in jail.
Same.
So in January 2021, in the northern part of Karachi, the White Corolla gang resurfaced and targeted 15 bungalows over the weekend. The dacoits fled the scene in a white Corolla vehicle, taking away jewelry and cash. However, it appears that this gang is a mere copycat. And unfortunately, this wasn't the only copycat gang. So to conclude this case, I must mention that as of 2024, Ali's whereabouts remain unknown. But Karachi seems to have been freed from the terror of the White Corolla gang. At least, I hope it is. You, listeners, let us know what you think. Do let us know about how you found this case. It was a little long. There were a lot of details to cover to give you the complete picture. And with that,
thank you for listening to Crime Stories of Pakistan, everyone. If you're finding our podcast enjoyable, a quick tap on the heart or like button would do wonders for our channel. Please and thank you.
Also, please share your case suggestions in the comments or email us at crimestoriesofpakistan@hotmail.com.
And as always, folks, keep those detective hats on, your curiosity bubbling like a fizzy drink, and make sure trouble stays in the rearview mirror.
Until our next rip-roaring episode, your host, Jihan,
and Naz
are about to hit the road.
Catch you on the flip side, crime buffs.
Bye for now.
Ta-ta.